is Blaine Bartell, and it is really good to have you with us on the program. We've got a special guest band. Their name is Whitecross. They're an exciting new group that has some great music. And we have a special edition of those wacky country cops, Muskogee Vice. What are we going to be talking about? Strife and how to stay out of it. It's not good to get in strife, right? All right, here we go. We got here as quick as we could, Geraldo.
I mean, Lieutenant, what did you want? Listen, tape's rolling. Why don't we move on with the scene?
Stubbs, you know you had food on your jacket?
Oh, yeah. Lieutenant, I've been meaning to get this jacket dry cleaned.
Suppose you guys know why I called you in here.
Yeah, for the Partners Against Strife Award.
As you guys know, the Partners Against Strife Award is given to the Vice Duo team that fight sin and dwell together in peace, unity, harmony, love. You know, the fruits of the spirit. The envelope, please. Merry Christmas from Aunt Lois. Who has an Aunt Lois?
Oh, I do, Lieutenant. I think that's for me. Thanks.
The envelope, please.
And the winner of this year's. And the winner
of this year's award is Sprocket and Stubbs. Job. You deserve a Hawaiian vacation, company Corvettes, and a raise in salary. We decided on something better. Two tickets to Silver Dollar City. Have a great weekend.
Have a great weekend.
I heard that.
Well, Stubbs, this is it. Silver Dollar City. You got the tickets?
I thought you had the tickets.
Stubbs, I put the tickets on your desk.
I don't have a desk.
Well, then I put them in your locker.
I don't have a locker.
Okay, I put them in your brain.
I don't have a brain.
Yeah, I know. You're a marshmallow mind. Tell you what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to go to the lady at the front ticket counter, and we're going to ask her for free tickets. Being that we are Muskogee Vice, shouldn't be any problem. Come on.
Absolutely not. If you don't have tickets, you're going to have to buy them just like everybody else. They're normally $15, but bearing in mind that you had free tickets and lost them, it'll cost you $27.50 each.
Oh, well, that's the way you see it. I guess we can do that. Tell you what, keep the change.
There is no change.
Good.
Oh, man, Sprocket, it sure is hot here. Hey, look, I forgot. I left the tickets in my hat.
Oh, great, Stubbs. Whoops, could you get those for me?
Hey, what are you two doing? Wait, aren't you that famous police team, Husky and Starch?
No.
Batman and Robin?
No.
Cagney and Lacey?
No.
Two words. Spigot. Second word. Tubbs. Spigot Tubbs.
No.
We're Sprocket and Stubbs Muskogee Vice, praise the Lord. What's your story?
Thought you might be some of that special security they sent up to us. We have a potential gang riot today.
What, the Crips and the Bloods?
No, worse than that, the Hatfields and McCoys. The manager booked the Hatfields for a weekend family reunion, not realizing that the assistant manager had already booked the McCoys, and that means big trouble.
Seems like everywhere we go lately, there's trouble. Come on, let's go. Thanks.
Sprocket, who in God's green earth are the Hatfields and the McCoys?
The Hatfields and the McCoys are the original family feud. Why these people have been in strife over some land dispute for generations, and they still hate each other.
Well, what do you think about that?
Well, personally, Stubbs, I'm on the Hatfield side. You see, my father's, grandpappy's, cousin's, sister's, brother-in-law's aunt was a Hatfield.
So that makes you a Hatfield.
Brilliant, banana breath.
Thank you.
Let's go.
So the guy for the nerdy cowboy hat's a Hatfield, huh? I'll have to keep my eye on him.
Wait, Sprocket, I think someone's got their eye on you.
Yeah, I've got my eye on her, too.
No, Sprocket, look on your shoulder.
Ooh, McCoy eye. Listen, I gotta go. Destiny is calling.
With a nerdy cowboy hat's over there talking with Lulabelle Bertha Beth.
And he's a Hatfield.
No. Hey, let's go tell Mama. When she finds out, she's gonna hit the roof.
Don't tell me Lulabelle Bertha Beth is in cahoots with a Hatfield!
Well, Ma, I didn't say in cahoots. I said in cowboy boots.
Shut up! Now, how come you two yard dogs didn't nab him when you had the chance? Hatfields! I hate them! The mere mention of the name makes my blood boil.
Ma, I knows we hates the Hatfields.
Yeah.
But why?
'Cause my ma hated the Hatfields, and her ma hated the Hatfields, and her ma hated the Hatfields, and her ma's mammy hated the Hatfields!
What about the men?
Shut up!
Okay.
Now, I want you two to get a scouting party together and go after them! Wait! Wait a minute. Maybe we've carried this strife thing a little too far. The good book says what we ought to forgive one another even if we don't know what we're forgiving them for. This could be the very day that would be the end of the strife between the Hatfields and the McCoys. It'd go down in history. Nah, go get them, boys. Well, what are you sitting there for? Get up, go get your scout party and bring them back. Dead or alive.
Hey, Lulabelle, Bertha Beth, that is your name, isn't it? Anyways, I just wanted to let you know that I believe this is going to be a very special weekend for the two of us. Hey, there's a McCoy scouting party.
Oh, Sprocket, don't let him know you're a Hatfield.
Would you... Listen, I was gonna tell you, but I just didn't want to hurt our relationship.
There he is with Lulabelle Bertha back!
Doc!
Where? Oh!
Come on, boys! Let's have a chase scene!
Woohoo!
I scared you for a minute, didn't I?
Hey, freeze! Hold it right there! Put your hands in the air! Don't move! Drop some.
Thanks.
Hey, wait a minute! We lost them.
Wait a minute. They weren't chasing us. We were chasing them in this chase scene, so that means they lost us.
Crumb sticks. All right. Is this where the Hatfields hang out?
Yep.
Good. We need some backup.
Do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do
It's a McCoy girl!
Yeah. Well, hold it right there. Put your guns down. She may be a McCoy, but you're looking at a Hatfield. Now listen up. The McCoy's got my partner.
Oh, capture that Hatfield varmint like you wanted.
That don't look like no Hatfield I ever saw!
Freeze the Muskogee vase.
Oh, yeah!
Can I go back in the bag? I got some handcuffs if you want to use them.
You idiot! Why did you get the wrong one?
But don't worry, we'll use him for bait to get his partner.
I got a plan.
So what do you say? You gonna help me or not?
Yeah, we'll help you, sunglasses. You're a Hatfield, ain't you?
Yeah, I'm a Hatfield.
Well, we'll help you.
Well, good. Come on, let's go right now. Come on.
But we got our own way of dealing with them McCoys. Turnabout is fair play.
Yeah, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth.
Wow, excuse me. We've got a plan. Bring it. Come on, guys. Let's make a bust for possession. No stumps. Guys, must have lost them. Have to do this one solo.
Ah!
Strife, let's go get ice. I'm coming to save my partner. This is getting real close to ruining my day. I wanted to ride the train. Thought maybe they might even, I don't know, maybe even let me drive the train. But no, Stubbs, it's all his fault. It's Hatfield's fault, it's McCoy's fault. It's everybody's fault.
Can I give you a hand there?
Well, I sure can. Just a minute. All I need you is put your finger right there.
Okay. Hey, you wouldn't happen to have any rope I could borrow, would you?
Sure do.
Oh, good. This looks like good stuff. Where'd y'all get it?
Got it over at McGillicuddy's. I'll make sure to tighten real tight or she'll get loose from there.
Okay. Thank you. I forgot mine. Sure appreciate your help. My name's Silly Sam Bonehead Hatfield. What's yours?
Billy Bob Beanhead McCoy is my name. Ask me again, I'll tell you the same.
Okay. What's your name?
I just told you. You're a Hatfield.
And you're a McCoy.
I've hated you all my life.
How does this?
Well, I've hated you longer.
Anyways,
well, you moved the property line back 5 inches, didn't you?
No, but your family took our drinking water and turned it into a septic tank.
Oh, no, we didn't. Your family stole horses from my family.
No, we don't even raise horses. We raise pigs. Anyway, your dogs doo-dooed in our yard.
We don't have a dog. We have a cat.
Well, he doo-doos, don't he?
Yeah.
No, he don't. Anyway, we got a litter box.
Excuse me, you guys don't even know what you're fighting about, do you?
And even if you did, it's not worth living your whole life in strife. Strife?
Strife!
Strife! There must be a lesson to be learned in all this.
Yeah. You never want to turn your back on a boll weevil.
No, you gotta forgive one another as Jesus Christ has forgiven you. Now, why don't you guys shake hands and spend the rest of the day in harmony?
Okay.
Pardon me.
These guys could have been killed. I hope you're real happy. Stop. Thank God you're okay, man. Here, let me help you. Listen, forgive me about the tickets and everything.
And the trophy?
Yeah, and the trophy, too.
And for making me drive the whole way up here?
Yeah, and for making you drive all the way up here. Listen, just forgive me for everything I've ever done, okay? Now, listen, partner against you know what? Hey, come on. I didn't even say Strife. That's not fair. Oh, Lulu, thought I'd lost you. Speak to me, darling.
Well, it's about time you got here. Now, get me off these stupid tracks. I thought we'd get married tomorrow, you know, and stay with Mom.
Yeah. Okay, listen, Stubbs, why don't we go catch the log ride?
Sure, but only if I get the front.
Listen, let me go in the front. You get wet more that way.
Oh, come on, Sprocket. You had the front last year.
Listen, come on. I'll tell you what, we'll ride it twice, and you can go in the front the first time.
Nah, you can go in the front.
Okay, I'll go in the front the first and the second time, okay? Wonder what the lieutenant's doing right about now.
I just knew it.
What is strife? Strife is quarreling or fighting or getting angry at somebody. And you know, the Bible says that strife is not to be done. In fact, Jesus prayed a prayer. He said, Lord, I pray that your will would be done on earth, in Matthew chapter 6, as it is in heaven. Now, what is God's will in heaven? What's happening in heaven? You think the Trinity are fighting every day? You think the Father's getting mad at Jesus because he did this? Or the Holy Spirit's upset at the Father because he did it this way? I don't think so. In fact, I know they're not. There's a perfect unity, and there's a love, a cooperation, a working together within the Trinity. And you know, God wants that to be happening on the planet earth, especially in the body of Christ. I guess I can understand when two unbelievers get mad at each other because they don't have a common purpose and goal and love like we do with Jesus Christ. But as a church, young people, man, we have got to begin to walk in love. We have got to show our colors, the colors of the Lord Jesus, to this world. And, you know, strife is a dangerous thing. It may seem like you just get mad at somebody or just, you know, you're quarreling or fighting and it's not really hurting you, but it's dangerous. The Bible says that where there's strife, there's and envying, there's confusion and every evil work. In other words, you open up the door for the evil of the devil to just run you over. Strife destroys churches, relationships, and it divorces you from the blessings of God. So wake up. Let's not fight against our brother and sister. Let's put on the armor of God and let's fight against the real enemy, Satan. With us as our special guest this program is a group that maybe some of you've never heard about, but are definitely blazing a new trail in Christian music, and their name is Whitecross, and I want to introduce these guys to you. This is Scott and Rex. It's good to have you guys on the program.
It's great to be here.
We'd like to find out where you guys are coming from, how you got the band started, how long it's been going, and what you're seeing happening out there in concert land.
Well, the band started close to 4 years ago, and very humble beginnings, but we just gave our heart and our talent to the Lord, and he's really blessed us. I met Rex. He was a guitar teacher in our town there in Chicago, and he was giving me guitar lessons, and he was looking for a vocalist, and I was looking for a guitar player, and we just got together, and I'd known Johnny, our bass player. We'd gone to the same church all our lives, and so Rex had known Mark, our drummer, because he'd played in the band years before, and so the Lord just put us together.
What do parents think when they drop their Christian kids off to your concerts and maybe see you guys on stage or hear the music from outside and it sounds as loud as what they thought it might be inside? What do they think of you guys?
Their first reaction is probably they're scared, and then...
Yeah, like we were talking during the break, they come to the concert, they bring their kids, and they stick around a little bit, and then after the concert, so many times we get moms and dads come up to us and say, you know, I don't like heavy metal, but I like Whitecross, and I like you guys, because they see what we're doing, and that we're, again, our number one calling is to be obedient servants, and when they see that we really got a heart for kids and for the Lord, and then they're behind it, and they will get behind us. And so many times we've done concerts where in our human strength we were just not ready, but we go out and we see ministry happening and kids coming to the Lord because of this mountain of prayer support that we get. And I know that we've got moms and dads and pastors and lots of people praying for us, and we really depend on that so much because we all need that.
I think first of all what we want to do is exalt Jesus Christ. That's our prayer before the show, and that is probably our number one predominant thing, is that we don't want kids necessarily to get so excited about Whitecross. We want to introduce who Jesus is to them, and because we know that if they see who Jesus is, then they'll accept him.
Because of Jesus, you can start again today.
We're going to take a look at a little music video here that you guys did, a song you did called Walk With Me. And Scott, you wrote the song. Why don't you tell us about this song? It's not a real rock and roll song. It's kind of mellow for you guys.
It is. Well, the first year of touring, I would just notice that after the concerts or before, people would come up to us and talk to us. And so many times the kids would say, different ones, they would come up and say, I've been a Christian for 6 years or maybe just a week, but it didn't matter. They would come up and say, I'm ready to just give up because of the sin in my life. I get so discouraged because I'm a Christian, but I keep sinning. And then I ask for repentance and I ask for forgiveness, and then I just do the same thing. I keep falling. And so I just really went to the Lord with that. And the Lord just showed me that His forgiveness is so awesome. We really can't understand it sometimes. That if we really knew His love and His forgiveness, that then we would just keep on walking with Him.
I want you to know. Mr. Collins, I sure appreciate you guys letting me stay with you while my folks are in Honolulu. And I miss my mommy and daddy.
Clarence, don't worry.
Be happy.
Okay.
Honey, I'd love to stay till Sis gets here, but I can't. I've got job interviews at work all day for the Christmas rush. Now, Doug, you and Clarence will be there after school, right?
Yeah, we'll be there, Dad. Listen, we're going to catch a ride with you. We'll be out in a minute, okay?
Hurry!
Clarence, quit feeding your face. They're going to leave you.
Sis, Blanche is here. Come on in, sis.
Well, finally, you put me on an all-night flight. I have to take a taxi from the airport. Nobody there to pick me up.
Well, you told us not to pick you up. You wanted to take a taxi.
Here, hold this. I have to go pay the taxi.
Oh, Blanche, for crying out loud, I'll pay the taxi. I gotta go. See you later. Bye at work.
I'll pay you back. Give me a hug. Connie?
Oh, this is Clarence, Doug's best friend.
Well, where's Connie?
Oh, she went to spend Christmas with Grandma Basil.
Oh, she'd rather be with Grandma Basil than Aunt Blanche. Where's Doug?
Hi, Aunt Blanche. Hi, Aunt Blanche. How you doing?
You've grown. You can use a haircut, though. I'll do that later.
Okay, come on, Clarence. Dad's in the car.
Wonderful. I just get here and everybody leaves.
I'm here.
Yeah, fine. Where's your ashtrays?
Okay, have you had any experience selling shoes?
No, sir, but I sure do enjoy wearing them.
Okay, now during the Christmas rush, it's very important to always maintain a real joyful attitude. Are you going to be able to do that?
I could sure try.
Well, that's what made America great. All right, now, during the Christmas rush, it's very important that you understand you may have four or five different ladies hollering at you at one time. You know, I want a 4.5 quad, I want an 8 narrow, I want a, 9C. Are you going to be able to assimilate that type of information and be able to service the customer properly?
Huh?
Okay, now, when you're working in front of the public, it's very important to be polite and mannerly, but I'm sure you understand that.
Yeah, I know that, baby.
Okay, now, the starting pay for this job is $5 an hour. Does that sound good to you?
Well, like, can people call me at work? Because, like, you know, I have to get my phone call.
Boy, with all the unemployment there is in the world today, there must be somebody out there who knows shoes, who doesn't burp, and who can carry on a decent conversation. Where are they? Where are they?
Hello, are you still taking applications?
Yes, 100 times yes. Do you have any experience?
Well, I was working at Wally's Shoe Mart across town until it closed down last week.
Sit. Great. I see you go to Union High School. You must know my son, Doug.
Doug who?
Collins, Doug Collins.
Yes, I know Doug.
Great. Well, your resume looks great. You don't burp, do you?
Of course not.
You just wouldn't believe.
You're hired.
So, Blanche, is there anybody special in your life right now?
Are you kidding? You know nothing ever turns out for me. And speaking of turning out, your marriage has turned out a whole lot better than I ever thought it would.
Oh, really? Why?
Well, I always thought Johnny and Susie would get married. I mean, they were madly in love for who knows how long. She was Mother's favorite until she broke up with Johnny.
Yeah, he just caught me on the rebound.
Praise God, I found myself a girl.
Really? Is her name Susan?
No, it's Melissa. She's going to start to work tomorrow. Good to have you here, sis.
I got something for you.
Hey, wait a minute. How come you got all the hair and I got all the good looks, huh?
Ding-a-ling.
Your sister is getting on my nerves. All of her.
Well, honey, she's just excited about being here and, you know, we're all the family she's got.
She is all the family I want.
Thanks, Ed. Hut. Doug Collins back to pass. He's his receiver downfield in the end zone. Touchdown. Yeah.
Hello, Doug.
Oh, hi, Melissa. Guess you're working here now, too, huh?
Yeah, but just for 2 weeks. But that's exactly what I wanted. It'll give me just enough money to pay off my Visa card. You know, buying all those presents for all my friends.
Oh, yeah. Hey, have you seen Clarence? He works here, too, you know.
Oh, yeah, Clarence. Isn't he the guy that wanted pom-pom girls to wear long johns underneath our uniforms?
Yeah, that's Clarence.
Well, why do you ever hang around with him? He is so weird.
Well, I guess if I didn't, no one would, right? I mean, it's a dirty job. Someone's got to do it. Actually, no. Clarence is the best friend that I've ever had.
That's nice. Oh, see you, Sale. Gotta go.
Okay. Marshall Collins with the ball.
May I help you, ma'am?
Yeah, I've got a big shopping list, and I'm getting sick of Christmas shopping. I'm just gonna get shoes for everybody. Do these come in mediums?
Yes.
Okay, I need a 7 for Annie, an 8.5 for Carrie, a 9 for Bethany, and an 11. You have 11s?
I believe we do in those shoes, ma'am. If not, we can stretch a 9.
Yeah, well, I'll take all of them then.
Yes, ma'am. Clarence! Get me these shoes for this nice lady, will you?
Yeah, sure. Here you go.
No, Clarence, in the back.
Oh, okay. You're gonna make a big ol' honkin' commission off this sale.
I hadn't even thought of that.
Yeah, well, can you put them on MasterCard?
Yes, ma'am, right this way.
So have you been in shoes long?
Oh, since about 8 o'clock this morning.
That's nice.
I'm terribly sorry. I'll have these stacked up in just a minute.
Don't bother.
I'm sorry. I didn't ruin that sale for you, did I?
Oh, no. I'm sure she'll be back.
I'll tell you what. I'll make it up to you. I'll buy something from you.
Don't buddy up to me. I don't see it as my duty to be friends with you like Doug does.
What are you talking about?
Doug told me himself the only reason he's friends with you is because nobody else will be. I'm not cleaning this up. You do it. It's your mess. What a loser.
Hey, Clarence, you big donut head. Let me give you a hand.
I don't need your help, and I certainly don't need your pity. So why don't you just go peddle your papers?
Sure, Clarence, whatever. What's your problem?
You can forget about that Mickey Mouse watch I was gonna get you for Christmas, bucko.
There's your balance. That's how I want you to do it. And this is the end of the day. And I'll see you in the morning at 9 o'clock, all right?
Okay. See you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Doug.
See you, Melissa.
Tomorrow after school, Mr. C?
Tomorrow after school, Clarence. Clarence, come here. You're the one, big man. We love you.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is wrong with him?
I don't know.
Kid's acting weird, Dad.
We love you, Clarence. We love you, Clarence. I bet you do. And Doug, this whole friendship thing's been nothing but an act? I bet the whole Collins family talks about me behind my back.
Oh, no, you guys. It's Clarence.
I just don't think I can act like I like him for one more day.
One more hour.
One more minute.
One more second.
Connie, would you get the door? We don't want to talk to Clarence.
Connie is at Grandma Basil's.
Mom, cut the drama. Let's just get the door. Tell you what, everybody get your happy faces. We'll pretend like we really like them. You ready? Hey, Clarence, good to see you, you old donut head.
Hi, Clarence, come on in.
Clarence, we really love you.
Boy, it's great to have you here, you old donut head.
I am a
donut head. I'm just a plain donut head. I am a donut head. I am a donut head.
What waist size are you now?
36. Why?
Well, in high school you were a 28. Do you know that's a difference of 8 big inches? I read something the other day that waist fat causes cancer.
As much as smoking cigarettes, sis?
Oh, don't start with me, John.
I'm not trying to start anything with anybody. I'm just...
Well, at least I don't smoke marijuana like you used to do in college. How did you quit that anyway?
You know very well how I quit. I got saved. I gave my life to Jesus. I repented of my stinking sins.
Oh, whatever works for you, sweetheart.
It worked for you too, dear.
Every time I turn on the TV and I see one of those TV preachers begging for money, it just turns me off.
Yeah, well, the thought of burning in hell in an eternal lake of fire kind of turns me off.
Speaking of burning, I think I'll go check my roll. Oh! Oh!
It's Aunt Blanche. I bet she's sleepwalking. Oh. I heard never wake up a sleepwalker. Oh. They get real hateful.
Oh.
I bet she's been woken up an awful lot.
It's my back.
Blanche, what on earth's wrong with you? Are you okay?
Oh, fine. I just live in pain. I can't sleep in Connie's bed.
Well, go get in our bed.
Oh, I couldn't do that.
Sister, go get in our bed.
Oh, okay. Good night, everybody.
Night.
Night. Now, Mama, if anybody's got anything to say about my sister Blanche staying here, now's the time to air it out. She'll hear us.
Being in the same room with that woman is like facing a firing squad.
Doug?
Well, I don't know, Dad. I mean, I think we ought to have her here all year long. I mean, she gave me $50 yesterday.
You guys, I know my sister's...
aggravating.
Mean.
Generous.
But we can't just throw her out.
No. 50 times no.
Well, I don't know how long I can stand this.
Mom, I feel sorry for her.
Well, sure. That's easy to say while she's asleep, but what happens when she wakes up?
She uses up all the hot water, fogs up all the mirrors, the same thing she's done every morning since she's been here. What do you think, Doug?
Well, Dad, what does the Bible say?
Bible says a lot of things, son.
I know, but one of the things it says is God's love covers a multitude of sins. And I know Annie Blanche has problems and sins, but, you know, if God can flow his love through us, maybe we can help her overcome some of those things.
Doug? It's good, son.
That's good, Doug. Really? You know you spoke right out of the Spirit then? Did you know that? Yeah. You did.
Yeah.
We were completely just carnaled out, and you spoke the word of God right out there. Hey, can I sleep in your bed? You sleep in Connie's bed.
Mom, Connie's bed is so hard.
Oh, come on, Doug. You can do it. You'll be a good boy, and I'll make you some fudge.
Okay.
Where am I going to sleep? Okay, ma'am, are any of these going to work out for you?
Well, I'd like to try that one just one more time.
Okay.
Dad, Melissa and I are going to lunch. You need anything?
Yeah, WD-40.
What?
Oh, nothing.
Da, 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 da. Must be nice to take money out of the cash register when you want.
Do it all the time. Ready to go to lunch?
Yeah, sure.
Well, let's do it.
Okay.
Are you sure you don't want to try a 10?
I've always worn a 7.5. Just keep working on it.
Mr. Collins?
Yeah.
Have you seen Doug? We're supposed to go to lunch together.
Yeah, him and Melissa just left.
Fine, I'll just fly solo.
Mr. Collins, I've done everything like you've showed me to, and we're still $50 short.
Well, I don't see how that could be.
Listen, I know Doug is your son, but Mr. Collins, I saw him take money out of the drawer today and put it in his pocket. Now, I'm not trying to get him into trouble. I just want to be honest.
Okay, Melissa, I'll take care of this. You go ahead and go out there and finish stocking the slappers. Doug, when you finish stacking the sloppers... Doug, when you finish stacking the stinking slippers, get in here because I need to talk to you.
Yeah, did you want
me to... Get your hand out of there. Doug, I want to be honest with you. I want you to be honest with me. Son, we've got to get toe-to-toe, elbow-to-elbow, knee-to-knee, chest-to-chest, head-to-head on this. Did you take money out of the till?
Yes, yes.
Why?
Because for lunch, Dad, look, I put an IOU in here just like you told me to, right there.
50 bucks for lunch?
No, just $5. Look, I was going to pay back
more. Where's the other $45?
Don't look at me.
Well, I didn't take it. And if I had, it'd have been okay because it's my money. Go on, get back to work. Sometime this year. Go on, Doug. Well, Melissa, that wouldn't happen to be my $45, would it?
Okay, I know. I'm fired.
No, Melissa. You're fired!
Yes, sir.
Now listen, Melissa. You've lied to me. You've stolen from me. You've tried to stir up strife between my son and I. Now, I just want to tell you this one thing. Unless you turn your life around and get right with God, this whole thing's going to follow you your entire life, and it's going to destroy you. Now, what have you got to say for yourself?
Can I pick up my check tomorrow?
Yes. Oh, Billy Graham, I am not.
Auntie Blanche, you're smoking in the Collins' house.
Shh. They're upstairs. I can't believe it. I can't even sneak a cigarette without some fanatic Christian making a big deal out of it.
Well, I didn't say you'd go to hell for smoking. You just might smell like it.
I suppose you want me to go find Doug.
No. Don't bother. See, I got him a present, and he probably didn't get me one, so... Just gonna leave it under the tree.
What do you mean? He's your best friend.
Well, that's what I thought till I found out he was just hanging around me because he felt sorry for me.
Oh, where did you hear that buffoonery?
Well, I heard it from Melissa, and it's true.
Well, little Miss Melissa got fired today. And there are plenty of people in this world that you can't trust, but Doug Collins is not one of them.
Ho, 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 ho! Merry Christmas, everybody!
Santa! Gnarly! Santa Claus! Santa!
Hello, Clarence!
And he knows my name!
Oh, it's Dougie! How you doing?
Fine, fine.
Hey, got a gift for you here, bud.
A gift? Wow, it's a brand new rubber ducky! Hold on a second, okay?
Okay.
Here.
Oh, thanks, Clarence. It's a little bit smaller than my gift, isn't it? But let's see. What is this little thing, anyways? Clarence! Mickey Mouse watch. Thanks. Hey, why don't you open my card?
Oh, you gave me a card. Merry Christmas to Clarence and best wishes from a best friend. Love, Doug. Thanks. I feel kind of bad because I didn't get you a card.
Oh, why don't you go out and get one for me, donut head?
because I don't want to, donut head.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Okay, everybody, let's gather around here, all right? We're going to have a great time tonight. Doug's going to play Santa Claus. Clarence, we're all going to have a good time. But before we do that, I just want to say this. It's the Lord Jesus that we give glory to this time of year.
John, I know I don't believe like you all do. And I'm not, as you say, born again.
Yet.
But the love that I've felt is real. And I know I'm not an easy person to love.
Blanche, I'm glad you're here.
Well, I've enjoyed it so much, I think I might stay past the new year.
Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your ultimate gift, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're so thankful for him during this time of year. We thank you for Clarence. Thank you for eggnog. We thank you for my sister Blanche. And Lord, we ask you to bless Connie during this time of the year as she's spending Christmas with her Grandma Basil. And Father, I just ask you to bless her, Lord. And Father, I know that some people recognize Santa Claus as the reason for Christmas, but we recognize him, Lord, as just a hoax. And we thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus. It's his name we pray. Amen.
Santa Claus? A hoax?
You know, I really believe we are in one of the greatest moves of God and are going to move into the greatest move of God that history has ever seen in our day. Just this summer, we saw 300 young people, as we combined with Teen Mania, that won nearly 10,000 people to Jesus in just a couple months. That's revival. That's a move of God. I was in Indonesia this past summer, and in just two nights, we saw over 1,500 teenagers give their life to Christ for the first time. God is moving, and you know, anytime there's been a great move of God in history, the devil has always tried to stop it. And the way he stops it is not from outside persecution. Because when you get persecuted from the outside, the church just gets stronger. It just makes you rise up and say, well, man, we're going to go on. But the devil tries to stop the momentum of the church and of the move of the Spirit on the inside. He tries to get believers in leadership fighting amongst one another. And if he can get us to fight each other, he can stop what God is doing in our time and our day. It's happened throughout history. There was a great move of God back among the Anabaptists, and the Holy Spirit was moving among that group, but there arose strife and dissension between other religious groups of that day. And in fact, it got so bad that the Anabaptists were drowning people during baptism. That's crazy. That's ridiculous. There's another great move of God just a few years ago when the healing movement came, and we had the great 10 evangelists, and we saw all the powerful miracles. But do you know that there arose such strife between some of the evangelists that they would literally pull their tent as far as they could to get their tent bigger than the next guy's tent? And that's not right either. And even in our day, we have seen different moves of God. You know, we've had movements and different areas where the Lord has been speaking to the church. And sometimes we try to build little denominations. And I don't believe denominations are wrong. I believe it's good to be organized and to have structure within the church. But when we have a denomination or a movement that excludes everybody else and we think we're the only ones, that again is wrong. And the devil will try to do that to stop what the Lord is doing. I don't want to see that happen with us and what God is doing with us as young people. Now, what are the causes of strife? There are many different causes. Sin brings strife. You know, when sin comes into a church, it gets people upset, and that can create strife. Sometimes, you meet someone that your personality just doesn't click, and it's hard to get along with them. That can create strife. But there's also some very demonic spiritual things that attack young people in the area of strife. David and Saul were a tremendous example of how the devil tried to bring in strife. David fought Goliath, and we all know the great victory he had, and the people began to lift David up and said, man, David's really something. And the king of that time, Saul, got upset. He looked at David and said, man, everyone's looking to David. Man, David's the king. I mean, David wants to be king, and the people want to make him king, and he's really something. And Saul got in such strife that he tried to kill David a number of times. And yet David walked in the love of God. David said, I will not touch God's anointed. Even though he was being attacked, he wouldn't respond with viciousness and with malice. Saul was jealous. He let jealousy build up. Don't let jealousy build up in your heart towards other Christians that are being blessed. That creates strife. God wants to bless other people. And when you get jealous and when you get upset because you see your brother or sister blessed, you're actually looking at God and saying, don't do that, like he shouldn't be blessing them. And that's not right. Also, another thing that can build up is pride. Pride is an attack of the devil to try to make you think that you're more of something than what you really are. It tries to get you thinking more highly of yourself than what you really are. You say, well, I've got Jesus inside of me. I'm something, man. Well, what was Jesus like? Jesus was a servant. If you've got Jesus inside of you, you're going to be a servant. You're going to have the love of God. I think about Jesus. Boy, what an attitude he had. He, at the very end of his ministry time, right before going to the cross, he took all of his disciples, and what did he do? He washed their feet. He ministered to them. That was what the lowest servant in the house would do, is wash the feet of the people of the house. And if you really have Jesus in you, you're going to be a servant, and you're going to resist that pride. And in fact, we got to get rid of that pride. The Bible says that God resists the proud. God won't even have anything to do with you if you have pride in your life. And so let the humility of Jesus Christ come into your heart and begin to seek to restore people. If you see people in fault that you don't understand, the Bible says to restore them in a spirit of meekness and love, and show the love of Jesus. God's love is inside of you, young person. If you're a Christian, the Bible says his love is shed abroad in your heart. And he wants to let that love come out of you and to bless the people around you. Amen. Hallelujah. I want you to pray with me right now. Just bow your head right where you are. Father, I pray for every teenager watching this program, every adult, that you would just cause your love, your compassion to be brought out. Lord, that they wouldn't see faults and they wouldn't see things in people that they don't like, but Lord, they would begin to encourage one another. They'd begin to build each other up. And Lord, if they do see something that is sin, they would go in meekness and in love to restore, not to ruin that person's life. Lord, I pray that jealousy and pride would be broken of its power over every person watching. In Jesus' name, liberate them to your power and your glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we want to thank Whitecross for being on the program. Don't miss next time. We're going to be having Renee Garcia, and we're going to be talking about being in the world, but not of the world. God bless. We'll see you next time.